Hey guys, and girls as well. Today we are very proud to receive with us Alexey Kolodkin. As you said on our trailer, he's going to talk about the virtual human. It's a very important concept because imagine nowadays you are like developing 7 mathematical models for biological system. But imagine if in the future you are able to gather all these mathematical models into a single model, big model. As you may already know by now, you also are going to have Jonathan Carr. Jonathan Carr, he developed, you may see, a smaller version, which was the virtual, the whole cell model. I met Alexey and Jonathan Carr at the same event twice in Como Lake. So I'm going to present briefly Alexey, but he already prepared for us his own presentation. I think it's even better because he can like update, he can talk about what he's doing. But essentially, Alexey is a data steward at the University of Luxembourg. He can update us, talk more about a little bit about that. Maybe for young scientists, it can be nice to know what is a data steward. He's at the moment, according to his LinkedIn page, he can update us if it's still out to date. He's at the Luxembourg Center for System Biomedicine. Maybe he can talk a little bit about as well about biomedicine, system biomedicine. And I'm going to leave him because he already prepared for us a short presentation. So it's even better for me because I don't have to run the risk to say like a stupid thing. You can like himself present himself. Alexey, your slide is shared. So you can show your slide and present yourself, please.
Okay, then I can go to the presentation. Hello, everybody. Let me share the screen. Okay, and let's do it like a PowerPoint. Okay, oh, by the way, I can see some little bit of delay, how it appears in YouTube and how it's here. Okay. Okay, thank you very much, George, for nice presentation, for introducing me. Just a little bit, 3 minutes about myself. Myself, I am from Russia, from Irkutsk, which is near Lake Baikal. I studied there at Irkutsk State University for physiology, and even I started PhD in physiology, but then I stopped it and started another master in chemical engineering because I wanted to apply something more, let's say, for environment. And I did this master in Tarragona in Spain, in chemical engineering department of University of Rovira, Virgili, and also started my PhD, but then I realized that actually my field is systems biology. And I did another master in systems biology at FU University Amsterdam with Hans Westerhoff and with Frank Brueggemann. This was, I think, very important time to learn what is really systems biology. And the most influential books of this time is the book of Hans Westerhoff and Ilya Prigozhin about complexity. And then I did my PhD already in systems biology. This is my PhD defense. Hans Westerhoff and Frank Brueggemann were my promoters. Here I'm receiving finally my PhD certificate from Hans Westerhoff. And the title for my thesis was Emergence of Design. So it was a bit already about virtual human. Then I started to work at Luxembourg Center for Systems Biomedicine in 2011, and since that I am working already for 10 years here. This is a Luxembourg University, and Luxembourg Center for Systems Biomedicine is one part of Luxembourg University. And while working at Luxembourg, I participated in knowledge transfer program between Seattle and Luxembourg. So I went to Seattle for Institute for Systems Biology for 2 years. And then in 2016-2019, besides working as research visitor at that time at Luxembourg University, I was also working at FU University Amsterdam, at University of Amsterdam, at Institute of Cytology and Genetics of visiting fellow in Novosibirsk in Russia. And from 2019, I started to work at Luxembourg University as data steward. So now I'm actually doing this data stewardship work. And what is very important part of my work is that from 2016, I started to work for Infrastructure Systems Biology Europe. And this infrastructure actually tries to provide professional, personalized fast and cutting-edge technology, helping people with their systems biological research. And the idea to use infrastructure is nice for people because they can keep their intellectual property, their patents. The discovery would be to them, and we just help from infrastructure to researchers. What actual systems biology infrastructure helps? The main support was with Make Me My Model, so we are providing modeling support. Also do me an experiment, so some experimental support with JWS Online, for example, model repository, with data stewardship, particularly using Ferrodome Hub, and also providing trainings on systems biological modeling. And as the main activity where I was working is Make Me My Model, so providing modeling services for clients. And within this project, we created many models. A lot of them were connected with virtual human, with kind of part of virtual human model, addressing actually human body and function of this body. And now in this talk, what I would like to tell you is that to present my point that virtual human is not just a concept in systems biology, but it's a kind of fate of systems biology. It's really destiny where systems biology should go, and it will go at some point, I believe. And we will discuss how reconstruction of biological behavior in silico lead to delegate our understanding to computer models, also in relation to virtual human concept. We'll discuss top-down, middle-out, and bottom-up approaches, and what does help us to build virtual human, some other approaches actually we use, and what does virtual human can bring to us, and we will discuss also some philosophical aspects of virtual human, and I will try to accompany my presentation with biological examples from our recent research. So let us start with this point. For some time, biology tried to explain disease in terms of mutation. So the concept was that there is one gene which is responsible, for example, for disease, and another gene is responsible for health. Of course, this is a very primitive situation. And this was based on the central dogma of molecular biology, that we have DNA, and then DNA makes codes RNA, and from RNA we have proteins, and we have kind of linear one direction. So if there is disease, it should be on the level of DNA, and then it will be reflected in protein and in phenotype. And sometimes indeed it works in some diseases, for example, in phenylketonuria, but most of diseases are too complex for that. So there is no one single gene responsible for this disease. So reductionism actually does not work for biology to explain all diseases we have. And we need something more, let's say some other approaches. Also, when talking about reductionist concept that there is just DNA and then RNA and protein, in reality it's a bit more complicated because proteins also make DNA. So we have also circle causality, and if system is broken, it can be broken in any place of this. So not necessarily on the level of DNA. And one old example of circle causality is experiments on fish, where researchers took nuclei, so DNA from carpfish, and inserted it into a nucleated egg of goldfish. So the idea was that this will bring us to create a carpfish, because DNA was taken from carpfish. But in reality, researchers got some absolutely different organism, and it was resembling more goldfish than carpfish. Then researchers introduced the concept that there is not everything is in DNA, but actually the cell as a whole can decide, and also cytoplasm decide actually which information should be taken from DNA, because we have all this advanced regulation, and also cell decides via nuclear receptors, for example, via different signaling processes, which genes system should read at this moment. So system is a bit more complex, and reductionism does not work. And another concept was emergentism. It was introduced already in 1925 by C.D. Broad. And by C.D. Broad, emergent properties was the properties which satisfy three theses. First of all, the thesis of systemic property. So it means that there are, let's say, elements A and B in isolation. They don't have this property. But when they work together, the new property emerges. So it's new emergent property, and it's present only in the system when A and B are components of the system and is not present in A and B when they are taken separately, just like elements. Another thesis is thesis of physical monism. So we consider all systems components as physical entities, so there are no supernatural forces in this concept. And also the thesis of synchronous determinism, that we cannot change biological emergent behavior without changing something in interactions between components. So if you want to change it, we need to change also how components interact. Still, emergentism, I said it may work, but it had one big problem, at least in formulation by C.D. Broad, that he distinguished between weak emergence and strong emergence. For weak emergence, it was, let's say, the emergence in nature when it happens, for example, that carbon atoms are arranged in a certain way, and then we get a diamond, for example, which is hard, or arranged in another way, and then we have the soft material, for example, like a chalk. And there is also strong emergence, which is related mostly with human mind. But we would like to argue a bit against this concept. There is also one publication of macromolecular networks and intelligence in microorganisms we published some time ago, where we try to claim that intelligent properties are also present in other macromolecular networks, like in microorganisms. And also, then in another paper, we formulated another concept that it's not only weak and strong emergence, but emergence can be weaker and stronger. So there is really gradation of strengths of emergence. And this strength of emergence depends on how much we need to take into account state-dependent component properties. Let us see this. I will explain what I mean. That when we have some components in the system, for example, A and B, let's say they are two proteins which interact, let's say, and bind together. And this interaction actually depends now on presence of other components. For example, there are some activators, inhibitors, chaperones, and so on. It depends also on hysteresis of the system. And also it depends on flow of mass and energy through the system. For example, if we talk about proteins and about some concentration, it's not only concentration is important for us, but also how fast we synthesize these proteins, how fast we degrade them. Because steady state concentration is one thing, but what is important is also flux through the system. And we also need to take this into account. And of course, we need to take into account initial and boundary conditions. So finally, it happens that in interaction between, let's say, two components in the system, there are a lot of other components also interact. So we need to take into account finally a lot of information about system as a whole and how this component properties now depend on the state of the whole system. That way they called state-dependent component properties because they depend on the state of the system. And the more information about state dependency we need to take into account, the stronger is the emergence. And nice thing that these interactions also taken into account the state dependency of interactions can be coded in mathematical equations and solved in computer. For example, let us say this is the ant house and animals interact, for example. And these interactions depend on presence of other animals. But this we can describe in terms of mathematical equations and reconstruct now the system in a computer model. And by this way, actually, we overcome this contradiction between holism and reductionism, because systems biology is holism and reductionism together. On the one hand, it's reductionism because we still explain emergent property in terms of interactions between components, between biomolecules. But on another side, it's holism also, because we need to take into account state dependence of this component property. So we need to take into account the system as a whole also. And this is actually one way of understanding systems biology. So this is already, by the way, if you talk about now about understanding human organism and we make the whole body model, this would be virtual human model. But now let us first think a little bit further. I will show just now an example how actually this reconstruction of emergent behavior in silico works, which we are doing in systems biology. This is our recent publication about reactive oxygen species networks, design, aging, Parkinson's disease, and precision therapies, and in Nature Publishing Journal Systems Biology and Application. And in actually our research, we try to understand emergence of Parkinson's disease. We know that Parkinson's disease happens because there is lack of dopamine secreted by dopaminergic neurons. And that way we have tremor in people, we have disorder of sleeping, and so on, disorder of mood. But lack of dopamine can happen because of absolutely different reasons. It could be lack of substrate. For example, in phenylketonuria, by the way, we have higher chance to get Parkinson's disease because we don't have substrate to produce dopamine, which is phenylalanine. And on another hand, there are results oxidative stress, which takes part because it can kill dopaminergic neurons, and then again they don't secrete dopamine, and we have Parkinson's disease. There are different mutations, there is pesticides, and so on. So a lot of factors affect it. And if you want to model now the system, we need to try to include them together in one model, and this we try to do in our research. So we analyzed 123 publications, and we used two different data sets from University of Milan, Bicocco, from University of Maastricht. And based on that, we tried to reconstruct emergence of Parkinson's disease from interactions between components. But of course, we took little, let's say, comparing with the whole body, we took only one fragment of the body, only some systems, only some molecules. And this is, of course, a big limitation because in reality, we need to take system as a whole, because this was a main critics, let's say, of our model for Parkinson's disease, because we did not include a lot of other stuff which other people think may be also important, because finally we need to include all body. And when we have in silico reconstruction in computer model for the whole body, then already we can have really precise model. Otherwise, if it is just a fragment, of course, there is open questions that how other components which are not present in the models will affect systemic behavior. And interesting issue here that in human brain, it's too much to include all components. So we cannot do systems biology now in human brain, not because conceptually it's not possible. In principle, we can make model on the piece of paper, but there are so many interactions that we really need a computer, and with growing computer power, I believe we will be able to include a lot of interactions. And we just tried to estimate them, and it's around 25,000 genes, 10 power 14 cells, and around 10 power 5 interactions is important to take into account, because although we need to take the whole body, it's not everything interact with everything, because we still have compartmentalization, we still have separate cells, and one cell interacts with another cell still in some limited number of molecules. Still, it's a huge number. It's too much for naked human brain. And that way we need a computer, and computers are getting better in this. And also perhaps in the future, we'll get a science done by robot scientists who can also do better experiments and generate artificial intelligence, can generate new hypotheses, and this can be tested again by robot scientists, by even without human mind. So we need to include all these interactions, we measure them, and we reconstruct behavior of the human organism in computer model. And when we go now to building virtual human, the whole body computer model, then we also getting closer to physics. These are words of Ernst Rutherford, who said that all science is a physics of stem collecting. And interestingly, what he meant by physics, he meant the physics of that time. Particularly in physics, we have some equations. So we can interrelate in this equation different systemic properties. For example, pressure, volume, temperature can be connected in one equation in ideal gas law. And then we can compute one systemic property if we know other systemic properties. Or we can compute systemic property from interaction between components. For example, from interactions between molecules. This was physics of his time, and by stamp collecting, he meant chemistry of that time. Because chemistry was just, let's say, a collection of different elements. It was still not discovered that one element can go to another. The effect of radioactivity was still not discovered. So chemistry was still stamp collected. And now if you see in biology, then biology was also for a long time stamp collecting. It's not only biology when we talk about different organisms, but also when we go to genetics, it was also stem collected. We have a big list of genes, and we have some ideas that this gene can participate in certain disease. But this is just also this list. It means stems collecting because they are not connected one to another. And now, when we build a virtual human, we build a computer model. Then we interrelate now different components, let's say genes, and integrate them together. Already computing systemic properties, systemic behavior. So by this way now biology becomes physics from stem collecting. But physics a bit different than, let's say, classical physics, because in classical physics it was just several equations. But in biology, instead of equations, we will have a set of equations because of high heterogeneity of the system. So we will have a virtual human model. And this will now help us to compute life and already and explain actually how biological behavior emerges from interaction between components. So this is possible in virtual human. And interestingly, that virtual human is a model. We can say, okay, it's model, but actually what we take as data for virtual human, it's also models. For example, when we talk about water, it's also our concept, our perception actually of water, because we talk about some electron clouds or some or just formula for water, which we took in our simulations. So data is actually also model. And then we just take, one perception of this data, and we integrate them together, and we make another model, which is virtual human model. So by building virtual human, actually, we don't do something absolutely new that we cannot make a clear border. Let's say that there is a real science when biologists do experiments and put formulas, and some like virtual human building when it's some very abstract thing, because in principle, all experiments, all our science is kind of modeling. And also all what we see in the world is the perception of this world. Its projection is to our system. So it's also kind of modeling. So it's just the difference of virtual humans that now this model will be done in computer, not in our brain, not on the piece of paper, but we delegate somehow our understanding to computer model. And when we build this computer model, we can start with three different ways, but they are very much linked one to another. One of them is data-driven. It was called digital human, when we start with a lot of measurements of emergent properties, and then we can go to interacting components, and we can already reconstruct the network of interacting components from measuring a lot about systemic behavior. Another approach is to start with interacting components, and this is so-called concept of silicon cell, silicon human, we can say. This is mechanism driven approach. So we first know mechanism, we measure this mechanism, we put it in equations, then we do another measurement for another interaction, and then we integrate it together, and then we reconstruct emergent behavior in a computer model. And another approach is, let's say, virtual humans, it's the middle out. But this is a bit, there are three approaches, top down, bottom up, and middle out. And in principle, there are three different ways, like digital human, virtual human, and silicon human. But in my presentation, I use virtual human without differentiating how actually it's built. And I think that silicon cell approach is used to build virtual human. So sometimes we can use it like a synonyms, digital, virtual, silicon human, but we can also say that this is a bit reflecting different approaches in building whole body human model. Now let us talk what helps us to build this model. You can say it's too complicated, but in reality, there are many things which facilitate building a whole body human model. One of them is that we have universal building blocks. So when we make model, we base on some building blocks, which are molecules, which are ATP, glucose, for example, and so on. And this number is limited. So interactions are limited also by building blocks used. Another thing which can facilitate building virtual human is domino approach and blueprint modeling. So in domino approach, we start building this model with some, let's say, several interactions, and then we incorporate more and more stuff, and we link them together. For example, we have some modules which produce ATP, other module consume ATP, and then using ATP as a linking molecule, we can bring these different models as domino tiles together. And this is domino approach, and this can help a lot in building whole body human model. Another approach is blueprint modeling. So maybe I can explain it in a bit more detail, that in blueprint modeling, we can have a blueprint. This is, for example, blueprint of human face. And then by changing just some features, we can obtain already particular instantiations of this blueprint model. So we can think also about biology, that there is some blueprint, for example, and all organisms, let's say, they are similar. They still have similar networks, and because of the origin and because of the same building blocks and the same solutions we found for all organisms. So in principle, we don't need to build separately all models, let's say separate model for, let's say, animal and separate model for human, but it could be the same model. And then with changing just small features, some parameters, we can easily change from one model to another, from one cell to another, because, for example, in all cells, we have the same genes, but just in some cells, certain genes are silent, others are working in another cell, other genes are silent. So if you make a blueprint model of the cell, then we can also easily obtain model for different cell types. And this is also based because finally all cells are coming from the same stem cells. So this also, and also if we don't need separate model for health and disease, for example, it could be the same model, but if we go to disease, we just do some change in the model, and then from healthy, it will become a diseased model. So this may help a lot. And we can also see that blueprint modeling follow our glass principles. So we have first a lot of data used to build a blueprint model. And then from one blueprint model, we can get already particular instantiations already, which can be specific for cells, specific for organisms, for human, for animal, specific for disease, if we talk about human model. So this actual principle is, let's say, observed in blueprint modeling for building whole body human model. Also, when we build model, what can help us is the concept that we can build first kind of ideally functional model. Because, for example, if we talk about some phenomena, let's say like a weather, for example, it's really, there is no specific attractor. But in biology, system is organized in a way to have it robust. So in principle, we can use this in building our model. So we can build, let's say, the model which is optimized for robustness. And then already, if we have, let's say, some disease, we have some perturbations and system deviate from this robustness. But still, it should be some, let's say, ideal attractor, ideal functionality in the system. And this may also help to build the model. And this is just an example in our publication on ROS modeling. We tried to use all these approaches. So we started to build model with describing how reactive oxygen species are produced and how they damage neuron and mitochondria. And then we incorporated more and more network features, including different stuff in the model. And then finally, we obtained more complicated model with already a lot of different proteins and genes, different signaling systems like NRF2 KIP1 signaling system, DJ1 signaling system, and so on. But of course, it's still limited. It's kind of the nicely fit to the concept of building virtual human, but it's, of course, it's only one fragment of virtual human. And as I said, using domino approach, we can make this model more and more complex. And finally, all models can be integrated together. And then we can reconstruct biological behavior in a computer model. It can be after more automatized, this process, as we also discussed. But now I would like to show you basically how we can use them if we now have a computer model of human body. For example, we can have model for healthy situation, but then we can also introduce in our model mutations. And for example, we can say, okay, let's see what will happen if we have polymerization of alpha-synuclein in the model. And then we can simulate and we can see how diseased model will behave differently. For example, here I show from our publication the plot how system collapses in terms of ATP steady state level in ES. So we can see that with mutations, for example, with alpha-synuclein, with DG1, with P62 mutation, system can collapse much earlier. And this we observe also in Parkinson's disease. And also we can see how different factors like coffee, for example, some medicine can help. So we can easily now do simulations and reconstruction of emergent behavior can help us now to predict what we should change in components in order to correct this emergent behavior. This can be also used not only for human models, but also for biotechnology. For example, this is our other publication about modeling sulfalobus, about studying some particular design feature in sulfalobus in archaebacteria, which live in high temperature and they don't have one enzyme. So instead of two steps from glyceraldehyde phosphate to 1,3-bifosphoglycerate and then to 3-phosphoglycerate, they can go straight from glyceraldehyde phosphate to 3-phosphoglycerate. So they have different systems. Then we can analyze already this in our model and explain why they have a bit different system for high temperature, but this can be used also in biotechnology if you want to design different organisms. And now I would like to go to some philosophical consequences from building whole body human model. So you probably know this Occam's razor principle that one should not postulate things without necessity, pluralitas non exponenda sine necessitate. And the idea of Occam was that if you have, let's say, two models, one model is simply, in his time it was model of universe based on Newton mechanics, and it has less entities. And we have more complicated model. It was anti-cosmos model. Then we have different gods responsible for behavior of universe. And then we should choose the simple model because simple model is more likely to be the correct one. And this principle was used a lot in science, and this was helpful. But now if you go to systems biology, then we think it does not work already. And instead of one should not introduce more things without necessary, we formulated it differently. Pluralitas non est eliminanda sine necessitate. This is actually, we developed with Hans Westerhoff this concept. It was also published in the paper Computing Life at Logos to Biology and Bias to Physics. And if we talk about systems biology, the difference comparing with the time of Occam, that now in systems biology, if we cut something, we cut not some abstract, let's say, gods responsible for universe, the behavior of universe, but we remove some molecules. For example, the simpler model would be just with few molecules. And the more complicated models include all biomolecules which are known. And all known interactions should be included. And of course, this model, the simpler model, to some extent, can behave similar or the same like more complicated model. But still, we should take the more complicated model as the most correct one. It doesn't mean that we should always use more complicated models, because sometimes it's easier to use simpler models, it's more practical, but it doesn't mean that simpler model is the most correct. We still think that the most correct would be more complicated model with more components included, because we know that these components are really exist, so they should be in the model. So we formulated this principle of binocular, that we should look for components and include them in our model instead of, let's say, shaving them away. On the contrary, we should include them. So this is just one interesting thing from approaches which bring us building virtual human. And now I would like to thank many people from Luxembourg, but especially Hans Westerhoff from the University of Amsterdam and Frank Bugert from the University of Amsterdam, who really encouraged me in this research, with whom we developed all these concepts together. And of course, also people from Luxembourg and George, very much because we also discussed, I remember, a lot of stuff with him about virtual human. And thank you, George, for inviting me here, and people from Russia, from Seattle, from Milano, from Netherlands, from Mexico. Thank you very much for your attention, and please, I would like to answer your questions. Let us see how does it work now. It's my first time when I do YouTube streaming. Let us see.
So, Alexey, thanks a lot for it's a very kind of you. I will just remove your slides here because yes. people can see us. But if you have something to show that you would like to show,
yes,
just let me know that I'm going to share again the slides. Everyone, remember that you can ask. I mean, this talk will be available after math, and you will still be able to talk to Alexey. I will make sure that I'll leave his LinkedIn page. If he has a public email that he'd like to share, like it's not a problem, I can leave on the description of the video, and as well, he can leave anything he wants, a paper, anything he wants on the description of the video. So Alexey, thank you for the talk, and you can start the discussion now. You all remember that you can ask, you can make the question in the chat. I will be able, it will appear here on the slide. So you can ask anything you want, but until you don't have a question, I'm going to make my own question. Okay. Alexey, I'd like to start with a kind of curiosity. We invited Hans to be here. Hopefully, in the future, he will have time to come here. I'm pretty sure that it's quite busy. One of the proposals that you did for him to talk about was the biochemistry, the title you suggested. Biochemistry does throw dice. I guess you are making a kind of a reference to the phrase of Albert Einstein that God does not play dice, and the Bohr said, Einstein, please let God play his dice the way he wants. I mean, that's what you want to say. I mean, God, you said, like on the proposal, biochemistry does throw dice. Maybe can you talk about more about that? I was curious about that because it was quite nice, the title, amazing.
Yeah. Actually, this was mostly introduced by Hans. By the way, he's also here. I can see him.
He did a question. His question just here.
yes, I see actually also this question. Okay, let me try to answer. It's actually very, very deep that, of course, what we observe. In biology, in principle, we can compute a lot of things. So finally, we will be able to reconstruct emergent behavior, but also I believe we will be able to reconstruct because let's say if we see, for example, we do experiments many times and we can get different results, and this can happen because of the reason, because it could be irreproducibility, not only because let's say we don't know everything. So, in principle, if we even include all information which we know, like when we put the coin, the idea that if we, let's say, if it falls on one side or on another side, if we know all forces, then we can really compute it. And now the question in biology, can we really compute the behavior if we know everything? But what actually I think there is also intrinsic irreproducibility. There are two ways. One, irreproducibility because we don't know all forces and we don't know, and system is open and still there is something happened. But another, it could be also inside of the, let's say, stochastic processes inside of the system. So there are two ways of this.
But can you maybe can you say that because that's the question that you can understand reality is not from biology, it's come from physics for years. Physics is trying to understand reality for years. There is a very nice book from Keller, The Models, I believe the name of the book. Let me just see the book here. I just opened here, right? Because I remember the curiosity for the book. And she talks about, because according to her, Alexey Keller, I forgot
the
name, but anyway.
Yeah, and basically I would like also to continue, because besides reconstructing biological behavior, actually following the question from Hans Westerhoff, also having the computer model may allow us to understand design principles of the system. Because then when we build a model, for example, we start with blueprint model, then we change some particular design feature in this model, we obtain, let's say, another system. We can also understand now how this feature affects the emergent behavior. And actually, by this way, we can also understand actually how a system is organized. Or, for example, when we use domino approach, we put one, let's say, module, then we introduced another feature, another interaction into our model, and then we get a new emergent property. We change this emergent property. Then it means that we can also understand now the function of this particular added component. So we also try to do it in our publications for nuclear receptor signaling for us, that we use model not only to reconstruct reality, but also to understand actually some principles underlying this behavior.
To be a kind of a descriptive model, like instead of just like machine learning, you are also like black versus white box model versus black box model, artificial intelligence versus applied math, the bottom up versus the top down approach. So we're trying to go as the, I think it was Dennis Noble that invented that, the middle way approach. I think it was him, right?
Yep.
Middle way approach was Dennis Noble.
Yeah, middle out, yes, it's mostly by Dennis Noble, yeah.
So maybe we have another question here about Hans, Professor Hans. Can you see the Hans questions in your chat?
Okay. Okay, yes, I agree what Hans says, yeah, fitness.
Maybe you can comment a little bit more. Can you do that? Can you, I know that he's a big guy, he's quite hard to follow his step, but anyway, maybe he's invited to come here. I mean, the invitation is open. If he wants to join us on the live, he can join. I just send him the link. He can join us wherever he wants. Anyway,
yeah.
So you do want to comment and think about his comment, or you can go on?
I just say that, okay, I agree with it. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So let me see if I can have for you here. So you said about a very nice part that when you talk about the Occam razor. Occam razor appears as a curiosity on the series called Dr. House. Initially trying to save a patient, then they try to use the Occam razor principle. Okay, maybe you said something, it's not just you, I heard this from Professor Hans, he used to say that as well when he's talking to Como Lake about the complexity. I remember that he put a sentence on his slides that he believes sometimes to the opposite, instead of just go for the simplicity as Einstein used to say that like you have to try, you have to go to the simplicity, but you think that biology is not so nice. Biology sometimes go to the complexity because sometimes the same gene can do several function. So simplicity is not always the way of biology. There is a model called the Okaik information criteria, AIC, and maybe you know this kind of technique that you try to select the simplest model. So maybe can talk a little bit more about complexity and simplicity in biology. Can you really make simple models, or you have to maybe accept that biology is not so simple as physics is? Maybe you have to go to complex model. You don't have a choice.
Mm-hmm. Yes, actually, we can make both models, and they can be useful in simple models and more complicated. In simple, we mean that we include less entities in the model. For example, less number of molecules, less interactions. And we don't say that simple models are not useful and we should always choose complicated model with more interactions. But we say that if we have two models equally well describing some behavior with fewer number, let's say, of interactions and with higher number, then we can, then according to Occam, we should choose the simpler model and say that it's also the most correct one. more likely it's to be correct because we don't include some extra, let's say, molecules in this model. But what we would like to propose that the more correct should be the more detailed model, because we know that these components exist. So if we remove them, maybe for this behavior it's still not so important, but model will be less correct. It could be the usefulness of both models could be the same, for example. We just talk about what is the most correct, and we cannot extrapolate this principle that a simpler model is the more correct one, the more likely to be the correct. This is how Occam formulated it. We think that more complicated model, more detailed model, let's say, more detailed model would be more likely to be the correct one.
Okay, Professor Hearn, he did a kind of comment. Can you see his comment?
Yes, sure. Yeah, important for the argument is that we know the complexity and then it is limited since we have the genome sequences. Yes, exactly, because in Occam he was fighting against the anti-cosmology. So there were two models of universe. One is Newton mechanics and another model based on more complicated interactions between different gods. But in biology, we know this, that there is a genome, we know how many genes are there. So in principle, we could expect that the more correct model would be, which include all these genes and all these molecules which are really present in life.
So maybe you can say that it was a kind of misunderstanding of his principle, that his principle is somehow correct, but was interpreted in a out of context way, like he... I'll give one example of what I'm doing now. Right now I'm studying a technique called the test-driven design. It's a different way of make computer problems. So instead of you do the computer problem, you first test your program, then go backward doing your code. So maybe this principle of the simplicity is more like this. It's a principle that you should go for the simplicity, but you should not. You not always get the simplest model, but you get the simplest model amongst the models that are correct. Maybe it could be more or less like this.
Okay, Hans, I would agree. Yeah, there is no basis for Occam's principles, really.
Yes.
In his context, in this time, it was useful for his particular situation, but it cannot be now extrapolated, taken like a complete principles for all science, let's say.
Yes, maybe that with the case of Einstein used to go for simplicity, but there is no proof that Einstein was correct. He used to say that the simplest model was the correct one, but it was a principle. There is no way that Professor Hans was the first one I saw in Como Lake. He wrote like a sentence. I remember that he talked about that in his talk. And I like the way he talked because sometimes you assume that something is true, but not stop thinking about that. Maybe it's just a kind of old way of thinking. In the past, they didn't have computer. Nowadays, you can solve an equation in a manifest way. So you don't have any more to go for the simplicity. Now you can build very complex models. Of course, you have to be careful because sometimes you can be overfitting. You can like to fit an elephant. It's not necessary to do that, but sometimes, but if you can go for simplicity, but you have to go complexity, sometimes you have to make a equilibrium, a kind of a balance between complexity and simplicity.
Actually, I would not agree, because this is not about what we should do. Of course, we should balance for our practical usage, but when we compare two models, then still if we have all molecules, if you have 22,000 genes in our model, this model would be more likely to be the correct comparing with model from 5 genes. Still it's. And we should not look for some balance in terms of, okay, 22,000 is too much and 5 is too little. Let's take, let's say, 10,000. It's not this balance. It's just we can use this model. Maybe it would be the most useful model. This is not complete and not simplified, but still, I believe that the more detailed it would be, more likely to be the correct one. So still with 22,000 genes, model would be more likely to be the correct than model with 10,000 genes.
Yes. So, yes, that's it. When you go through biology, you have maybe to rethink that maybe the idea of physics is not completely correct to biology. So in this case, you have to go to complexity. There is no choice. I mean, you said something very nice when you talk about the, because if I understood properly, you said that the biggest change nowadays is not that you are not able to understand biology, that the computer has a kind of limitation. Maybe in the future you have a more powerful computer, maybe you'll be even closer to the virtual human. So virtual human nowadays is not just a matter of that you don't have the knowledge that is necessary. You don't have computer power. So maybe in the future you have a computer to make, for example, molecular dynamic simulation of drug. So it means that the future will be able to predict the three-dimensional shape of a protein, but now you can't, not because you don't know, because you don't have computer power for that. So maybe that's, I believe that's your point, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but computer power is growing, yes, and...
Yes, let's see. One thing as well I'd like to ask you, because the first time I heard it, you like to use a sentence of, let's see, Professor Hans, he has a comment here.
Ah, yes, it's very nice comment that if you have 25,000 genes in our evolution, so they're very important, because this is another point why we have 25,000 and not, let's say, 10,000. So in model also they should be important for reconstructing the behavior. Yes.
It seems as well that the majority of the gene, they are like blind, if I remember well. Most of them does not seem to have a function. Most of them, at least you don't know yet how they work. So maybe, because one thing that is interesting about system biology, when I was studying system biology, I found that rice has more gene than human, but the complexity of human is much higher. So you have more or less the same amount of gene of a rice, alpha mice, but you are much more complex than a mice. So it seems that the connectivity between the gene is much more important human than it is on another, like emergent property. You said a lot about emergent property and so on. So it seems that the emergent property may be the explanation for human complexity. It's not about number, it's about complexity. It's about connection. It's about emergent property, I guess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
Okay, there is a sentence that you said once to me, like we would like exchange email to write that possible paper. Unfortunately, the time was not enough. But anyway, you like to use the sense that from chemistry, that chemistry, I believe Rutherford said that the chemistry was a stamp collection. We were the first person that said that to me. I love that sentence. I guess... one of the consequences of this is that when a biologist they publish a paper, it seems that paper is like a little bit more like a short title. Like I know that phenomena. The paper of a biologist, they have a kind of single attack. They attack just one thing per time. It seems that biologists, they work as a stamp collector, even when they write paper. Yes.
Yes.
I don't know. You agree with me?
Yes. Yes. Exactly. Because chemistry was stamp collected, but now it became physics because we know radioactivity and we can now compute, let's say, how one element is transformed to another element. And in biology, it's still stamp collecting because we have list of genes and we say, okay, these genes may be responsible for that, this for another. And in the only difference that in biology, we cannot find one equation. It should be like a really set of equations, like complete whole body model. So this is basically virtual human would be kind of physics for biology. Or in principle, it's not only human, it's virtual organism, silicon organism, just a computer model, reconstruction of biological behavior in a computer model. And this is actually physics for biology. And it seems all science goes to this way. So that this is actually my point, that it's not something that we would like because it will be useful. Of course, it's true. We would like to have this whole body model because it will be useful. But it's also kind of a destiny how science develops. So we will arrive to this point.
So suppose that you have a biologist watching this vision in the future. Suppose that you have a biologist. What would you say to this biologist regarding stamp collection? Would you advise them to make like go wild? start to publish a paper like a big theory, like the mass equation of what would you say to biologists in order to maybe to improve this like draw? I would say maybe I cannot say, but I can say that a drawback. Yeah, I do not know if it's a weakness, but would you say that it's better to change this way of thinking? The biologists should change this way, or maybe they should keep this way and somebody else go there and make the connection? Because molecular biology was able to make a very good work. Dennis Nobel, they say in his book that he's not against molecular biology. He said about molecular biologists was able to do an amazing work. Now we go one step more. Would you say that the biologist should keep doing the same kind of paper, like a very punctual paper, or they should change their mind and think more in terms of systemic thinking, like system biology thinking?
I believe that one particular research in molecular biology should be well integrated in the general, let's say, building the complete model. And actually, we are going out of this way because now, for example, it was raised, okay, that people use different, let's say, names. Now we have, let's say, universal name for all, let's say, biomolecules. And we have it machine readable. We have special codes, for example, for proteins, for mRNA, for genes. So it goes in the way that finally now molecular biology also develops, all biology develops in the way that it would be most suitable for integrating it in one model. And actually, this is also kind of, now we discuss, for example, a lot about FAIR principles in biology, that all research should be findable, accessible, interoperable, and reproducible. But one way to make it FAIR, it's actually to integrate all research in the concept of one model. This is kind of model-driven data management. That, of course, we can make a research, and then we can first take care that this research will not disappear. This is already, I think, important step is done. So now, for example, all papers, when you publish something, they ask you not only your conclusions and your results, but they also like to have your data and your data accessible for other people, that everybody can check how you manipulated his data, how you computed what you did actually with them. This is already first step. So now we don't have just paper, we have paper together with data and with your codes probably, and how you, that anybody can reproduce what you obtained. And next step would be model-driven data management, not only to put everything and to store it in correct place and secure and so on, but also that one piece of research is integrated with another piece. So if somebody is doing research, that immediately his research, he measured, for example, he found some other molecule and he understood that this molecule activates some process, let's say, in some metabolic pathway, for example. Okay, he discovered this. The idea is that it's not just goes to paper, but it goes directly to the database, which is integrated and immediately can be integrated in the bigger model which other people are building. So it's not necessary that all biologists start doing modeling, but it's important that all research and all results would be, let's say, first of all, suitable to be incorporated in the model, and also to have some infrastructure, how it's arranged. So it's not necessary that researcher who is doing his research in the lab, he should do it differently. He can use the same equipment, do the same research, but it's more taking care about his output, that he measured something and it goes to some other database, and not only to database, but to the model directly. This is what I think will change.
Yes, the first time I felt this was on my PhD. I was modeling the body weight control. I was modeling ghrelin. I noticed that it was quite hard to, because first of all, the data was hard to find. They never did the kind of data thinking that somebody else could model that your data. So they think like just two biologists talking to biologists. So one other thing that what you said, I used to say in my talk as well. I used to give talk to the Tandem on Science in Italy, University of Luck, to medical doctors. I would say to them, please, when you do a model, take into account somebody else may want to model your data. So please, as you said, keep it public, keep the code public. There was a very nice talk from Professor Gunner from Netherlands, and she her code's all available on GitHub. I think it was amazing because if you want to use her code, it's there, you can use. But it's not yet a widespread phenomenon. Some people still have hesitant. They're still hesitant about to make their code available. They're still hesitant about to make their data available. So I think that's a very good advice you gave. I think you should listen to that as, the biologist.
Yeah. Exactly.
So I would like to raise another point because there is a sentence that I heard a lot. The sentence. Some people say that it belongs to Bohr. Some people say it belongs to somebody else, but it seems to belong to George Box. He used to say, all models are wrong, but some are useful. What about the view to human? Can you maybe build a model that have that model that are not? Because if all models are useful, some are wrong. So maybe you'll never be able to make a correct model.
yes, but all models, but then everything is a model. On another hand, what we see around us, it's also kind of our model, the projection of the system to our brain. So we can also say it's wrong, because what we know about our life around, it's also kind of model. Okay, and this is actually a difficult question, because what is actually the world? It's probably it's not only what we have in our brain and what is in our understanding and our concepts, how we perceive it. So and the same if you go to science, it's of course it's still the model, and okay, but I still think that it could be models more close to, let's say, to life and less. So it's not that only usability is the criteria, but the criteria can be also the correctness of this model also. It can be that some models are more wrong and some models are more right. I think it's true, the statement. It's not that all models are equally wrong and only some of them useful, but I think also some models are more wrong and some models are more correct. Yes. It's just my opinion. Maybe you don't agree with it.
No. I agree completely. Science like this, you disagree, then someone is maybe is wrong, maybe is right. Anyway, there is a very nice picture that you put on a slide. I don't know if you want to make reference to that. You put a picture of a robot trying to play chess. There is a very famous match between Kasparov and the computer.
Yes.
At the time, Kasparov lost because the computer was brute force. But nowadays, the computer can beat even Magnus, because the computer has artificial intelligence that can be even better than Magnus, the best of the world nowadays. Maybe, do you believe that the maybe biology will follow the same step? First, you are going to beat biology with brute force. Then later, you are going to beat biology with artificial intelligence. Because even if artificial intelligence nowadays is very strong, the model is still very weak. If you compare what the brain can do, if you want the best artificial intelligence can do, we are still very far away. So maybe you are going... What's your opinion? Do you think that you still have a long way to go to beat biology, or still have what do you see as a scientist? Do you see that we still have a long way to go to beat biology when it comes to model?
Because what do you mean beat biology?
Still by beat biology, I want to say to be able to make a model that is virtual human, that really has a... Because nowadays, our models are very simple. You have to say that, because I believe, that is my opinion, our models nowadays is still a toy model when you compare to what biology can do. Maybe your opinion that it's a matter of computer power. If I understood properly, your opinion that maybe in the future we have more strong computer power, we'll be able to model biology in a much better way now. But what about if we need to be more intelligent? Like first you beat Kasparov if you brute force. Then later we beat the artificial, we were able to build artificial intelligence. What about do you really have to be brute force first? Or do you believe that you can make better models, more intelligent models before you are able to reach the limit of computer science?
Mm-hmm. It could be maybe also related that, let's say, the doctor. We can also kind of try to beat model because some experienced doctor perhaps can be still better than computer model, saying, okay, what is needed for the patient. He can see the patient, and by his intuition, by accumulated knowledge which he has in his model, internal model, his internal model can be better, let's say, than virtual model in the computer. And but I think it also goes in the way that soon the computer models would be better than just a doctor. So this would be also another way of how we go to doctor. We don't need to see a person and rely on his experience, but we rely on experience of kind of all doctors integrated in one model and all information integrated. And for example, I would trust perhaps more to this artificial intelligent doctor than just one single doctor when I go, let's say, to bring my analysis, my DNA sequence, and get some advices. And actually Hans is commenting on this, that we can already make models that beat the human brain, for instance, to understand some counterintuitive principles in biochemistry. Yes, yes, of course, it's there. So for now, we already beat,
Yes, anyway, I'd like to make a question. It's a mixture of questions. It's a kind of a question, because what you said now came to my mind, the kind of, let me explain where the question comes from. When I was giving a talk to the third one science, like 3 months ago, a medical doctor, which is a friend of mine from the University of L'Aquila, he's a medical doctor. He does not work with mathematical models. So I would like to ask you to, I respond to him with my experience. Now I want to ask you to respond to him with your experience. He asked me like this: suppose that a mathematical model make a mistake. Who will be responsible for the mistake? Because it's about artificial intelligence. Maybe in the future the model is going to help the medical doctor. But what about if the model makes a mistake? Can you maybe that's a big fear to use model, because you don't have legislation for mistake of a model.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Understand. It's a very interesting thing, because of course if doctor makes mistakes, it's one doctor, you can blame him. But if now somebody did not quote something,
it's random, what did that?
Because it will be distributed then responsibility. Like because knowledge now, it doesn't, that for example, one doctor, he accumulate all knowledge. But now let's say the computer model, the virtual human, will accumulate knowledge of all society together. And it's mean also that mistake would be distributed between all people who provided experimental information, who did coding, who designed this model. I think, yes, it would be no probably single person.
Would you agree with me? I said that to him. I don't know if you agree with me. Do you agree with me that nowadays you don't have a strong discussion about that? I mean, I believe you should discuss more about that, because we do our models, but you are not talking about the responsibility. For example, if a medical doctor uses your model, I believe you are not talking about that. I mean, in a serious way, like who's going to be responsible? Nowadays you have the agency that is able to judge if a medication is good or bad. But what about in the future? We have an agency that is where we make a protocol to say this model is reliable. You can use this model. So this is the protocol to use this model. This is the model, like you do with drugs, like you do with experiment. So far, I don't think that you have protocols. Do you have protocols? I don't know. I think you are like a little bit lost with models. Just make the models.
It should be. And one nice thing in models, that if there is a mistake, then this mistake can be really identified and later can be taken into account not to make it second time. But if you talk about single doctors, okay, perhaps the same mistake happens, let's say, several times. One doctor made mistake, and in another country, several years later, another doctor can make again the same mistake. And it will not learn from this mistake. But model, in principle, we can learn. And we can correct them something if we see that, okay, our prediction was wrong. And what also Hans, I see, he is saying some comments that complex models need to be tested to reduce the number of errors, of course. There will always be errors in them. We know this from the software industry, of course, yes, but it's always errors, yeah.
Yeah, but I think the question of this professor from the University of Lux, Professor Maggio, I think his question is because we don't have yet, for example, if you use a drug, and this drug, for example, I love medical doctor series. I like Dr. House, I love Grey's Anatomies, I love Dr. House the most. But as you see there, of course, that's a fiction. If they make a mistake, but the mistake is under protocol, they have no punishment. But if they make a mistake, the mistake is not under protocol, the punishment is bigger. So suppose that a medical doctor wants to be a revolutionary, Dr. House of the future, wants to use model. So he's able to see Alexey, Professor Hans, go there, Professor Hans, please give me a model. So he starts to use his model the patient. But yeah. Unfortunately, something goes wrong. The medical doctor will be responsible, I guess.
Of course, he always can say that my predictions are based on the model which I got, so I'm not responsible. Yes, the same like protocol. If he used some protocol, he knows that, okay, you should give aspirin in this case, and then he gave aspirin, and then person died, and because of his very individual gene combinations. And the same can happen with model. I think it's referring to model like similar to protocols or not?
Yes, I thought about protocol because when you do a protocol, you know precisely what to do. I mean, if you have to do this, you have to do that, it's a protocol. Like in Brazil, the vaccine has to be approved by Anvisa. So why it has to be to approve by Anvisa? Because Anvisa gives you a protocol that you have to apply this amount, you have to apply this, you cannot apply this way. So you know if you make a mistake, you have a protocol. You follow the protocol, so the problem is not mine. I mean, I made a mistake, but I followed the protocol. In the case of a model without protocol, if the medical doctor, because the point is like this, there is a very nice talk from Daniel Kahneman. Daniel Kahneman, he's a premium Nobel. I love his book. He wrote a book about noise, and I saw his talk. He was talking about the difficulty of, you said about that you trust you. You said like this, I prefer to trust artificial intelligence in the future than a doctor. I agree completely. But, for example, he said about emotion. His book is about noise with emotion. Mm-hmm. So it's true that a medical doctor can make much more mistake because of emotion, because of noise, than artificial intelligence. But I guess we still have a long way to make the model like reliable, like people start to trust. Like even today is difficult because sometimes people is afraid. Like I trust people more than I trust model. But you know that model in some cases better than human. But I guess one of the biggest difficulty will be to teach the society, the medical doctor, the society. You gave the example of the vaccine in Russia. It seems that some people are afraid to take the vaccine. It's not a matter that the vaccine is not safe. It's a matter of public opinion. People is afraid. So we know that if you not change people's mind, even the model, the best model for the world, people are not going to use the model. So I guess one of the biggest challenges is not about the right model. It's about changing people's mind, the culture, and so on, I guess. I don't know if it makes sense to you.
It makes sense, but still, I think, for example, if you talk about vaccine and models, that if people would get a model for them saying, okay, that you have 0.01 chance of complication after vaccine, and you have, let's say, 5% chance to die from the disease, they would go more for vaccination. But now they don't have this model, and they have just opinions of some people whom they trust and don't trust. So they see that somebody in news said, oh, model, let's say vaccination can kill you, and then people believe, because also they don't have real numbers and they don't have computation. I think actually this, for example, model for vaccination, especially personalized maybe model, that people put his genome and then model say, okay, how much chance for him to get complication and how much for him to chances to be, let's say, protected from COVID, it would help to increase actually percentage of vaccinated people.
Okay, one more question. One thing that bothered me is a lot, bothered me as a young, I would say young scientist, is that because sometimes you make very nice work. As I was seeing the talk of Professor Hans, your talk, all the other people, amazing people, I was very surprised how amazing the models are nowadays. But in your opinion, how far maybe, how the state of the art regarding the transition between reality, academy, and the application? I mean, theoretical like models and clinical medicine. I mean, do you have any experience to share in which you were really able to convince a medical doctor to use your model? I mean, do you have any experience? Do you know any case that an medical model was able to really be applied in a new situation?
Mm-hmm. Actually, I think in this respect, there is principle all or nothing. So if we have a lot of models which are still not good enough, and that way people are not so interested in them. Because but it will be very, let's say, big change if you have one good model, because it's also if you have, let's say, model is not good, it's not useful at all because nobody will use it. But if you have model really, let's say, several steps more advanced and better, and if it will be shown that it really, let's say, can reconstruct the behavior of the human body, and not only just one small fragment, because now mostly in models you have just fragments. Also, what we are doing, because our forces are limited, so we are doing just small bricks, but small bricks are not so useful now. What would be useful, the complete model, the complete building. And this, I think, is a bit of crisis now of systems biology, because people expected a lot, and now we still have just separate bricks, and still there is not a complete building. When they have this complete building, everybody will appreciate it. But before this building is completely built, it's becoming more and more difficult to build it, because people say, oh, you produced already so many bricks, and still we don't have shelter from rain, for example. We still have diseases. So people a bit disappointed with that.
But I guess...
It's a bit of a problem, I think. It's not so gradual. If, for example, maybe in other sciences you can make a little bit improvement and little bit something becomes better. You purify water a little bit better, you get a little bit less diseases, so it's kind of gradual process. But in building a virtual human for medical application, it's really something all or nothing. It's if you build a little bit something, it's not so useful and nobody is interested in that. But you need to build it completely. You need really to have a big advance. And you need the patience for that and resources for that. And unfortunately, I think people now little bit disappointed to invest in this.
Yeah, but I guess, maybe I'm wrong, but I guess some small models, they are already doing very, very good result. Because, for example, I saw some models of insulin for the virtual pancreas. They are doing very good. I mean, not like the whole picture, but they still are doing very good results. So I guess the big picture can wait somehow, because I think even the small models, when they are used with caution, they are doing somehow well in some situation. Of course, you don't have a model like the master equation. Even physics nowadays looking for the master equation. They don't have the master equation. So you should not wait for biology as well to have a one equation going to solve everything. Maybe that's the only thing that you have, you should look for.
Yeah, indeed.
Okay, I would like you to change gears a little bit, just a little bit, because this channel, I'm also trying to create a new way of, I mean, a kind of new base of my channel, because so far the channel was all about biomathematics. So I did a postdoc recently that I was able to participate from a startup, the Applied System Biology, and I was able to design a web application, so on. So my question is, suppose that you have a very good model. Suppose that your model for systems biology work. Suppose your model for systems biology is approved. This process of transform your model innovation, such as you build a software that you are able to deliver to the society. Maybe can you talk a little about the difficulty of innovating biomathematics, creating models for software, for the society, the challenge of the industry, and so on. I mean, if you understood the question, I don't know if I was a little bit all over the place.
No, I understand you, and I think it's really a very important point, because even if you make a good model, but doctors are not able to use it, it will not be so useful. And to teach them, it's a bit complicated. Because, for example, model should be also put in nice, soft, and nice and easy to use. And this is a very important part. And we should orient not only on good model, let's say, for ourselves, that I can open this model and change there some numbers and do something. But it should be really something with clickable buttons.
That's
easy to implement. I think it's really a very important step. So I think it's very nice initiatives. So you are designing now, right? This
I built, but my postdoc just finished. So I guess they will go on their own, because I was a postdoc, so I did my job. I had a fellowship, so I finished the postdoc, and I guess they will have to find more money, because I mean you need money. So my scholarship finished, but I'm still trying to go on if my own initiative, like at least trying to create a culture, to create a kind of trying to fight for the idea behind that you should not always make model. You should as well pay attention that your model will be used by somebody else. And most likely, this person has no idea about parameterization. They have no idea about biomathematics. So you should do something that's very easy and straightforward to use. When you drive a car, you have no idea how the car works, but it's to drive a car. So maybe your model in the future, I believe that's not to be so easy because sometimes it's complex, even for us to make parameterization, but you still can try, like to make a web application. I'm studying right now how to use deep learning with JavaScript for web development. And you already have very powerful ways to do this kind of simulation. Of course, I don't think that you'll be able to make like a very strong simulation using, in my case, you had to use like two servers, one server for head calculation, the other server for web application. But we already have very strong tools, and you have changed somehow the culture to think that there is always a client that's going to use your model. I don't know if you understood my point.
I absolutely agree, but also be careful because you talked about who will be responsible. And most probably doctor will say, I did according to protocol, I clicked the buttons. And modeler will say, my model actually is correct. It has all equations inside. All equations are right. But the result was wrong. Perhaps maybe it was some mistake. The doctor did not press the right button, for example. So it's...
Yes, I know.
It's a very important job and very important that it's actually a big challenge, I think, because one thing is modeler, he really knows how everything is linked, and then you have to make it simple enough, but on another hand, to be able still to use everything from this model, all this flexibility.
But I think that, of course, there will be a kind of limitation because, as I was saying, sometimes it can be hard even for us to make parameterization, because if you make a parameterization, the model gets unstable. In the case of MATLAB, what they do, MATLAB create a kind of default set. The default set is optimized. So they say, if you want to change the default set, it's your business. So sometimes you make things like this, you create a model, it's already working, it's already okay. If you want to change the parameterization to make a kind of event behavior, be aware that this was not tested. So maybe I did that same question to a professor from Brazil. She said something very nice. She said, you are going to need to train people. Maybe that's the point. You need to create the software and train someone to use the software. Maybe. But the point is that you should start to think about that, because when you build a model, in the case of, I was talking to you that I'm studying a technique called the test-driven design. So the techniques try to change our mind, because instead of making the code, you think about the test. So you force yourself to think that your code can fail. So maybe start to think about how somebody else is going to use our models. You are going to start to think about how to make the best way possible to be simple enough. I mean, we talked about in the discussion about the simplicity, Professor Hans and you and so on, you raised a very good question, because sometimes you cannot make the model simple. Maybe when you build a user-friendly interface, you have the same problem because you cannot make it very easy to use. But anyway, you can try at least.
Yes.
Alexey, I think that's all. Do you have anything more to say that you would like to raise?
I think we discussed already a lot of interesting things, very important things. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed the discussion.
Yeah, you are welcome. You can come back whenever you want. Professor Hans, I don't know if he's still with us, but his invitation is still up. You can come here and maybe add some first-hand discussion. Appreciate that to be quite valuable to the channel. I'd like to thank you a lot, Alexey, for accepting my invitation. You are very kind of your part. And as always, the invitation is always open. You guys can talk to Alexey. I think he's quite friendly. I can let you know for sure that he's quite insightful, quite friendly. And he'll be glad to answer your question, to collaborate and so on. And this video will be available after all, it will be available, you can see it later. I'm going to maybe to select some part of the, it was quite nice sometime. I wanted to see, this part was quite nice. So I'm going to make some edition of the video.
Okay.
So Alexey, thanks a lot. So it was nice having you here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.